Okay, we welcome Dr. Niki Moutsopoulos, who will talk about the work in oral immunity and infection, the history that brought you to where you are today, and how you envision the field evolving, if not exploding, in the area of oral barrier immunity or oral mucosal immunity, so critical for oral health.
Thank you, Rena, and thank you, Pam, for including me in the session. It's a pleasure to be part of this inaugural symposium celebrating NIDCR. And I first wanted to highlight some of the critical work that has been done in the intramural NIDCR before my time that has really formed a lot of the understanding of the field of microbiology and immunology, especially as it pertains to periodontal disease. So I want to bring up just a few colleagues that were there before me. One is Joe Oppenheim, who was really considered one of the fathers of cytokine research. And Joe did a very interesting experiment together with colleagues in the 70s where they stimulated PBMCs from periodontitis patients and isolated a factor which, when they would add to osteoclasts, osteoclasts would come activated. That was found to be IL-1 beta. And really, that was the first ever experiment to show that inflammation triggers osteoclastogenesis, that inflammation can be a driver for disease pathology and diseases such as periodontitis and arthritis. The second person I'd like to acknowledge is my own PhD advisor, Sharon Wall, who really was also a guru in the field of cytokine biology and gave us a lot of interesting insights into the contextual nature of inflammation. She worked with TGF-beta, and she showed that the same molecule can be tolerogenic or pro-inflammatory, depending on the context. Together with Wanjun Chen, who is now a senior investigator in our institute, showed that TGF-beta can trigger the differentiation of regulatory T cells. But when you have TGF-beta in the context of inflammation, it becomes pro-inflammatory and can drive immunopathology. And this really, ideas of contextual nature of inflammation are important for periodontitis and really any setting of disease or inflammation. And finally, and I know in the audience here we have fellows from Paul Kollenbrander, I wanted to bring up Paul and say that really many of the work that was done in the future, thinking of the complexity of microbial communities, started Paul's thinking of the complexity of these two adherent microbial communities and the interaction between the bacteria there. And so fast forwarding to the future, I have to say that I've spent my whole life as a student and then an independent investigator scientifically within NIDCR, and that's been a tremendous privilege. It's a place that brings together interdisciplinary research, a lot of talent, and really one of the places that you can move the whole spectrum from deep basic scientific approaches to clinical research and back. And because of this amazing environment, it allowed our group to start such a program where we start from human patient observations, we go to the lab for mechanistic understanding of biology, and are positioned together with colleagues in the NIDCR and in the NIH to go back into the patient bedside or chair side and try to attempt to try novel interventions. And one such case that I wanted to bring up is our work on leukocyte adhesion deficiency, which has been an amazing partnership between NIDCR and AAID and extramural colleagues such as George Hadjishengalis, in which we first studied patients with this disease, and such patients have tremendous periodontitis early on. We saw a dysregulation of a cytokine response called IL-17. We've been working for years on the basic mechanisms of immunology related to this immunopathology, but because of the NIH environment, we were really within a few years able to swiftly go back into the patient side, target this pathway first in a single patient and more recently in an approved IRB clinical protocol that is still running at the NIH. And in the answer to your question, Rena, what I hope is that this leveraging of rare diseases that we're trying to do at the NIH is gonna give us at least two types of insights. One, basic biology as it relates to human disease, because we can go from patients with monogenic disturbances to understand biology in the human setting. And hopefully insights towards more common forms of periodontitis and potentially abilities to think of targets of host modulation for periodontitis as well. So thank you for including me again.
Thank you. Well, certainly not as complex as the questions we ask on cancers, right? That whole interaction of the exposome and genes and environmental interactions. How do you put that in the context of periodontal disease? I mean, the common form. Yeah. And so that we have some handle on how to control biofilm production and healthy microbial systems.
And again, I, you know, in this room, I'm humbled to be the only person answering these questions about periodontal disease, so I apologize for that, but I'm the one sitting here. But, you know, when in periodontitis, at least the more what we used to call aggressive, but really early, like younger patients, severe forms of disease are the ones where we want to think of genetics and try to see, and those are also the types of forms that we see in underrepresented minorities, mostly in African Americans and Latin Americans as well. So that, for me, the genetic paths there are the ones where the monogenic might be where that will help us mirror some of these findings. And that's where, for me, the genetic kind of predisposition plays a bigger role. But it's not going to be one answer for all types of periodontal disease, I suspect. Yes.
Thank you. There's Tom and Dyke and others who would be great to join in the discussion. We can have it after.